The reason we planted the church really is simple. It maybe sound a little trite, but it was a call of God. That my wife and I were living in the city, and in our particular community, there weren't a lot of Bible-believing, Christ-centered churches. There were a few, and they were doing a decent job at reaching a certain segment of the community. But for my generation, for my peers, the people who came from more of the mindset and the background that I did, there wasn't a real good church home for them. At least that was our conviction. And so we began very simply with a small Bible study in our living room and a bunch of like-minded people, and just trusted that God would continue to add to that, that there were indeed a number of other people that needed a place to be in relationship with Christ and in relationship with one another. And so the church really has just grown out of that simple beginning, and hopefully will continue to grow from this point forward.
God's just amazing to give me the portfolio of clients that I have. I have pictures on Nirvana's album, from Soundgarden to Alice in Chains, which were the grunge bands, as well as Radiohead, Catherine Wheel, Duran Duran, I've done them, and just, you know, as well as Christian bands, Jeff Moore in the Distance, Grandma Train, I've done both their albums, MXPX, Blenderhead, you know, the Pearl Jams, the Billy Idols, the, you know.
The number one thing that draws them to street talk, or that keeps them listening, I think that the music and the topics and the commercials gets them to listen the first time. But the thing that keeps them tuning back again and again and again is the fact, I believe, that they feel that this program is genuine.
The strategy is pretty simple, actually, in how we're trying to reach these kids. It's kind of like putting cheese out for mice. You build these ramps, and kids come from everywhere. They're not primarily coming because they want to hear about God. They're coming because they want to skate these ramps. And it's really effective, though, because the guys that are on staff skate and relate to the kids and tell them about the Lord Jesus Christ. And a lot of kids, through relationships and through these ramps, hear the gospel and believe in Christ and start following him.
In this day and age, it's rare to see a church full of young people. Even more strange is to see this taking place in a cultural trend-setting city like Seattle. This generation is known for being skeptical and carefree toward the world around them. It's a generation caught between passions of the heart and reasons of the head. So what can be done to reach this generation? How can we better understand the generation in transition? Pastor Mark Driscoll comments.
Categorically, the way we classify people when we do ministry has traditionally been either by where you live, and so we built community churches for people to go to church in their area. Later, it became by denominational affinity, so you're a Presbyterian or a Baptist or an Assemblies of God. Then the church started to subdivide people into married, single, further subdivided into high school, junior high. What we're finding now is that the church is trying to define people by generations. This is really a fairly new trend. And so Generation X, those that are basically teens to early 30s, are a category of people that they're trying to define. And there's a few demographics that help to give a handle on who they are. About half come from divorced or broken homes. About a third are physically or sexually abused at some point in their life. Many of them were latchkey kids, kind of raised themselves. They were the first generation that was really inundated with a heavy content of media, cable television, MTV. These were a lot of kids that were raised alone because they didn't have siblings. About a third of the generation was aborted, which just right out of the womb, to even be here, is a success story. And so they came out not necessarily being wanted in all instances. And then as a result of abuse and marketing and the busyness of their parents and fragmented homes, they tend to be very skeptical, really street smart, and very leery of authority. It's something that they haven't had much experience with. So that is part of what defines the generation. The thing that makes the generation most difficult, though, is that philosophically, it's a bridge between two different worlds. Most churches tend to be either theologically conservative and culturally conservative, or theologically liberal and culturally liberal, and our church tends to be theologically conservative and culturally liberal. People dress and listen to music and experience art forms that would be considered unacceptable in most mainline evangelical churches. Yet when it comes to the authority of the scriptures and the love for theology and good teaching, I would say we have an appetite as good as any. And so it's often confusing. The liberals don't like our doctrine and the conservatives don't like our worship, but at the same time we feel very comfortable in that place. We're living in the biggest cultural transition, philosophical transition in at least 200 years. As the modern Enlightenment project is being deconstructed, nothing else as of yet has been constructed in its place. Houston Smith out of Syracuse says that postmoderns are men with hammers. The unfortunate thing is they only know how to break, they don't know how to build. And so as the critique of the Enlightenment project continues to tear down what has been in place for the last 200 years, the church has a great opportunity to be the answer to the postmodern question, to be that authentic, relevant, supernaturally driven, believing community that can answer the questions that the culture is seeking. My fear, though, is unless the church struggles in the three areas of epistemology and how people think and values what they care about and aesthetics, how they receive God in the form of community and expression, then it'll lose a great opportunity. My fear is that modernism has so crept in and taken over theology that we are so tied to our system of thought that it may actually destroy our opportunity for evangelism. There are elements of great mystery and wonder and truth that exist in a lot of traditions, be they Protestant, Orthodox, or Catholic, and oftentimes you're forced to pick a category and to start to defend a system that you may not even entirely agree with just for the sake of harmony. Fortunately, as an autonomous church, we have the ability to borrow from those elements of church history that we find to be most authentic to who we are and to be most in agreement with Scripture. And so at some points our preaching may look more evangelical and our service may look more liturgical and our view of the arts may be more Catholic, but at the base of all that we believe that it's all biblical and that it stems from biblical conviction, not just from cultural trend.
Agreeing with the philosophy of Mars Hill Fellowship, one family commutes over 75 miles from the city just to attend. Each week, they pack into the RV and head for church. Under most circumstances, a long drive can get old. For this family, a long drive is worth being able to share with and be a part of the Mars Hill family.
With the relationships that I do have with people there, I see a lot of growth. Whereas a year ago, a lot of them were just baby Christians, and they've really excelled in the ministries that God has called them to. And I think that's real important, that young Christians feel important to the body of Christ and that they can express their giftings.
Kids aren't like, I think what they need is just to have everything laid out, just to be told the truth and have it be told in a way that's understandable, how you can apply it to your life. And the way that Mark teaches is he really makes it a part of our life, and he just really communicates it really, really well. And he gives it a look, like tells it like it's a story, so that you can understand instead of taking little bits and just like blurting them out here and there. He ties everything together extremely well.
If I've learned anything in the last 10 years of my life, I've learned that young people don't want gimmicks. They want the truth. And everybody says they're presenting the truth. And all these preachers say, this is the truth, here's the truth, here's the truth. No, there's the truth. And so I just find that we need to live the truth and allow God to do his work in individuals, and they'll come back and they'll respond.
Unfortunately, some commutes can take longer than originally expected. Recreational vehicles, like traditions and trends, are known to break down from time to time. This is the problem between the modern and the postmodern world. What traditions and trends are we going to hang on to? Caught somewhere in the middle, this generation wrestles with a head in the past and a heart in the future. Unfortunately, we can look to that which we have in common. This will help us find a balance between the heart and the head. Entertainment photographer Karen Mason spends a great deal of each work week interacting with today's most popular musicians. Some see the music business as a dark industry. If this is true, Karen sure seems to have no problem shining the light.
I do. I agree with that, you know, people can call me outspoken. I believe I'm very energetic, and I believe it's all Jesus. Because he gives me life, and I just love to live life and let God live in me and live through me. And most of the time with these bands, I mean, there have been on occasions where I do share the gospel of Jesus, and I'm not saying I don't, but I'm open to it. Every photo shoot, I'm willing to say, Lord, whatever you want me to tell this band, I'll tell them. And most of the time, all I hear is God just says, love them, because I'm coming to give. Everyone else in this industry is taking from them. Their idols, their you know, worship, their what rock star, you know, alternative rock star, whatever, you know, and God just says give. They're just totally, they're miserable. They'll tell you that. They're not happy. They have millions and millions and millions of dollars. I mean, millions. And they're not happy. They're not What is it? It's like they've dreamed all these things and they got everything they ever wanted, but the problem is they don't have Jesus. So nothing can fill that void in their life except Jesus Christ. And what they do is they just have to eat more of it. You know, the hole gets bigger and you have to feed it more of this evil stuff. So it's, oh, we need more of this, more of that, and more fame and more everything, and the hole just gets bigger instead of gets smaller, and they become trapped. They're victims, you know. And so much of these people, they'll make comments, like they'll say, I always like to throw out a truth, like I'll say, well, there's no rest for the wicked, or something like that. And if they chomp on that, then I give them more. But if they don't like that truth, they're not going to like Jesus, because Jesus is the truth. And I find with these musician types that, I mean, you look in their eyes, and you can almost see their feet. They're so hollow. It's like you look all the way down, because they have nothing. They're just blank. I would share a scripture with the believer or the non-believer, and what I usually say, this is my line, it says. I don't say it says in the Bible. I just say it says, like I'm quoting a book. So I always just say, well, you know, it says, you know, we're to love our neighbor. You know, it says, if you only love those that love you, that's not love. You know, that's not really love. It's to love the ones that don't love you. You know, it says that you should forgive. And they'll be like, wow. And they'll never even ask. No one's ever even asked, where does it say that? You know, they just get so convicted, they don't even care. Because the word of God goes forth and it heals. It heals them. And I always pray, I say, Lord, what do you want me to tell this person? You know, the Bible's a thick book. There's a lot of things in that Bible. It says God is he has life-giving words for each person. And so I say, Lord, what is the life-giving word that this person needs? Because God knows their heart. I only know them. I know their situation. But I don't know their heart. And God knows what truths they have and what they're tangled in. And it says Christ came to set the captives free. So I say, Lord, what is it? What do you want me to share?
So you can try different things and test it. But in the end, you're still left wanting. You're still left hungering. You're still left thirsting for something that lasts, something that is real to the core. Oh, dear, my master planted.
contractor by trade, Lief Moi spends his days at the construction site overseeing projects. However, every Saturday night, he finds himself in front of a microphone, hosting a national radio program geared toward reaching Generation X.
Live from Seattle, the talk show where truth is absolute and ignorance is optional. Street Talk, it's food for the soul. Now your host, Lief Moi.
Good evening and welcome to Street Talk. My name is Lief Moi, and we're here for the next 3 hours to give you straight answers to tough questions and hope in what often seems like a hopeless world. Tonight, the topic, the Street Talk.
When I first started doing the program, I was very dogmatic, very absolute, very, this is the truth, live with it or burn in hell type of thing. And it's effective for a certain group of people. The boomers loved it. The elder people loved it. But I don't know for sure if I was connecting as well with some of the younger audience that I wanted to. And as a result, my average age listening to the program was in the 30s. Now, I've changed some things. I've changed the way I approach an issue, approach a topic, approach truth, not compromising it, but the way I deal with it, explain it, and my average age has dropped down into the 20s. I'm very rational thinking, very linear thinking. A plus B equals C, and C minus B equals A, and on and on and on. I think very logically, whereas much of Gen X thinks very cyclically, round. Everything's relative. There's truth is kind of abstract. It's left to the individual to determine what's right. And I don't think like that at all. Doing the program because we genuinely care, because I genuinely care about these kids, and I think that they recognize that. And so they keep listening. So one thing that this generation will catch on to is phonies and frauds. Gen X, age-wise, is 18 to 32, under 32. They're the kids of the boomers, known as the slackers, whatever. You know, they've got all kinds of labels to them. They're basically the young people that have grown out without mom and dad at home. It's really the first generation, at least in this country, that I can think of, first generation, I would have to say, in history that I know of, that has primarily been raised outside of mom and dad, whether it would be from a daycare center, babysitters, school, outside sports, or just friends, each other. Because mom and dad, for reasons of financial or whatever, parents just trying to pursue their career to be somebody, have chosen to put their lives ahead of their children's lives. And I would say that would probably be one of the key characteristics that would define Gen X of who they are.
My name is Paul Anderson, and I'm 34 years old, and I'm the pastor of the skateboard and inline ministry at Central Bible Church. Skate Church is pretty much a target ministry, targeting skateboarders and inliners in the greater Portland area. And pretty much what we do is evangelize skaters through building ramps and getting their attention here. And then once kids hear about the Lord and get saved, then we begin discipling them. It's like a youth group just for skateboarders and inliners. It just went like 3, 6, 25, and 50. And then within about, I'd say about 2 months, we had 125 kids skating the parking lot here at Central Bible. And I was just kind of thrust into ministry, not really knowing what I was doing, but just knowing that I knew the Lord and I needed to tell them about Christ. The kind of kids that come to this skate ministry don't really fit in a traditional youth group. You know, they're, like I said, skateboarders are kind of a subculture, and their dress and who they hang out with and their activity is completely centered around skateboarding. I mean, they live, eat, and breathe skateboarding. They watch the videos, they wear the clothes, they do it all day, all the time. So they're kind of secluded. They're not like mainline kids. A lot of them are actually, especially when I started, were kind of made fun of for being skaters and stuff. And a lot of time they go to the youth group and the kids are, you know, they're not doing the stuff that they're into. They're playing chubby bunnies with marshmallows or scratch the friend's head, scratch the head next to you, and singing these weird songs. And they're just kind of like, what is the deal here? And so they don't want to hang out with the youth group scene. And that's why I think there's a need for us to do the skate church. I really believe that if the Lord Jesus Christ was on the earth right now, that just like when he was here, he went after the tax gatherers and the sinners and the pagans. He was called a friend of tax gatherers and sinners. I think he'd go after this ostracized group of kids that the law is pretty much saying, don't skate here, it's illegal. The teachers are, don't bring those boards here. Their friends are like, you know, who? What are you? And I think the Lord actually has a heart for these kids to reach out and show them his love and his truth, and that he really has a plan for their lives. I remember when I first became a Christian, the vocabulary of the church, I didn't even understand what they were talking about. You know, all the big words like walking with God and propitiation, sanctification, justification, salvation, all the Asian words in the Bible. What are they talking about, you know? And I think that, in fact, I made a sheet of about 200 words that the church assumes everyone know what they mean, but people are like, what does that word mean? And so they just need to change their vocabulary, their music, and their vulnerability, like their openness, so that people understand what they're talking about. I actually tell people that there's like five axioms of skate church if you're going to start one. And these are things we've learned either through scripture or just doing it for 11 years. And the first one is clear confrontational gospel preaching. That we don't want to be ashamed or shy around the issues, but tell kids right off the bat, skate church exists so we can tell you about God. And the reason why we built these ramps is to tell you about the Lord. And if you're willing to hear about him, it's for you. But if you're not, then this is probably not for you. And then to preach the gospel about sin, righteousness, and judgment. The Holy Spirit comes into the world to convict of sin, righteousness, and judgment, not love, joy, and peace. And they need to hear about those things and hear about how God loved them enough to take their judgment in the person of Christ by taking away their sins so that they can be righteous. And that's what we tell people. And the other one is prayer. I can see a direct link between how much we pray and how many kids get saved and how they're growing. And I just, it's dramatic. When we pray, the Lord's hand is moved, and when we don't, things don't go on. The other one's kind of obvious is good ramps. You know, you can do a lot of preaching and a lot of praying, but if your ramps are booty and they don't work, then kids aren't going to come and hear you preach, because what initially gets them is the ramps. They got to be good, and you have to keep up on what's going on in skateboarding and keep changing and talk to kids and keep them up. But that's the hook, the ramps, but the prayer and the word is what gets to their soul. And the other one is integration into the local church. You know, I encourage people not to try to build a church within a church, but to do their best to try to get these kids saved and to get them into other meetings in the church, because they need to be part of the family of God. Skateboarding is primarily kids between 11 to 25, all guys, and that's not a very balanced view of the body of Christ. They need sisters and mothers and fathers and brothers and grandmas, and so that the program should initially aim to get the kids in the church. And that's kind of my burden for churches being more relevant, because when you have a ministry like this that catches the kids in a relevant way and meets their needs, and then you send them to church on Sunday and they're just sitting there like sleeping and not knowing what's going on, it's a little bit frustrating. So you need a church that'll work with you on that. And then the other one is clear structure and rules. I mean, these kids mostly are rebellious and have a bad attitude towards authority, as you know, the rest of the kids in their generation. And they're going to take you as far as they can. And so we just have the rules, like this is what goes and what doesn't, and consequences. And we don't take the idea that we're going to try to be your buddy. We're going to be your leader who cares about you, and these are the standards. But if you blow it, then this is where the door is, or you know, you can come back next week and when you get that taken care of. And what it happens is kids realize we're serious and they respect us and they listen and they have a good time, and it becomes an environment where it's different than where they're living. They come here and there's not a bunch of kids snaking each other and cussing each other and fighting. People aren't stoned and on drugs. It's a place where there's actual consideration and care for one another, where there's Christian influence and leadership. And these kids are like, they're like struck by the difference between when God is kind of over a situation compared to the way the world is, and they see Christ even in that structure and rules. And though they buck it at first, it's attractive to them.
Reaching a generation in transition won't be easy, but at least we can follow their advice.
After you hear Marcel, I guess the one thing I would suggest to those who have like-minded dreams or visions is that you're not alone, that there's thousands of young leaders and ministers that God is raising up across the country. Lots of people are attempting to form authentic communities relevant to their cultural context. And my admonition would be Psalm 37:4. David says, to delight yourself in the Lord and He will give you the desires of your heart. I believe that every work and move of God begins with His people really learning to enjoy Him and to be with Him. And out of that, He places desires on our hearts, and then in His sovereignty, He brings them to pass. And so if anything, the hope is that people would not create more churches or create more ministries, but that they would draw closer to Christ. And out of that well, things would happen that would reflect that relationship.
First thing, it's going to take a long time to reach someone like me in the state where I was, but first thing you can do is be my friend and show me that you care. I learn much better through example than I do through a bunch of words and preaching.
I think kids just want a lot less than we think they do. They want sincere relationships. And like I said, everybody needs value.
I think if I could tell a parent something, you know, that would help reach me before I became a Christian, I think it would be to let me know that I'm actually doing something important. Because I think a lot of parents, they have this thing, you know, no matter what their kid's doing, it's not good enough.
They're so afraid of my generation and so afraid of us that we're so rebellious, and they don't know why and they don't know what to say, and they think we're just going to be like, wah, you know, and just totally rip them apart and tell them, you know, F you and I don't care about it. But the best thing they could do is kill us with kindness.
To be real and not try so hard to get to us. Just, you know, not put on an act, say what we want to hear, but give it to us straight.
So the first thing they'd have to do is approach us. And that's the big thing for them. But once they were to approach us, they can't come out and start spewing God.
I just, you know, because then you're not getting all legaled out. You know, you're not getting all serious, because serendipity, it convicts you. It's like the knife that cuts you free. It cuts you free, but it cuts you. You know, and I'm not being all, you know, heavy on them, like really sawing the knife on them.
They were the whole focus was just trying to get kids there by food and snacks and goofy movies, you know, of some kind of sports character trying to act cool and claiming that they're a Christian, you know. And it's all like they're trying to make it look a certain way so that we'll grab onto it, and they think that they have to change it and, you know, put makeup on it and make it a different gospel, but they don't.
Okay, if a guy today walks in here with you know, a necklace and some earrings and purple hair, everyone don't stare at him, because he's here to find Jesus, like all of you are here. You know, it's just because he has purple hair doesn't mean like Jesus is going, that guy must exit the temple.
I think it's possible that we're living in the day of the Second Reformation. I believe if Romans was the book of the First Reformation, Ecclesiastes may be the book of the Second. And Solomon says something very amazing in chapter 7. He says that the man who fears God avoids all extremes. And what we've seen in many traditions and in many churches is extremes of experientialism, of dogmatism, of liberalism, of conservatism. And hopefully we're entering into a new time where we can strip away those things that are cultural, strip away those things that are traditional, and get back to those things that are eternal.
Grace in our lives. Here's our